This one on the corner is going to be Waskaway Abbott. The farmer that picks our grain up is named Randy Abbott. So kind of in honor of his service, we're naming that one after him. Yep.
What's the BBL bottles by liter?
That's barrels. Yep.
Barrel bottles.
Yeah. How many U.S. gallons are in a barrel of liquid? Anybody know? About half of that. Yep. A lot of barrels are in the mid 50s as far as gallonage, physical barrels. But as far as liquid barrels go, it's 31.25 U.S. gallons. So we can, it's a 30 barrel fermenter. We can ferment, you know, 34, 35 barrels of beer in it, depending on just how big the batch is. So about 1,000 gallons of beer in one of those.
Barrel metric.
Yes, I think so.
No, barrel
is it? What's that? That's not metric? Oh, okay.
Yes.
I'm being told it's not. And I believe that. I don't know.
Gallons are not metric.
Yeah.
They're English.
All I know is a pint's a pound the world around.
Right. Yes, I'll go with that.
3.7
Yeah, we'll step back there. Unfortunately, most of our free space is being used to store things. We didn't can today. We got a delivery, so we won't be able to see a lot of it. So back here is the canning line. You kind of have to imagine. A horseshoe shape. Over here to the left is where we load the empty cans on. And we get the cans just as without a top, and so they get loaded on, they hit the conveyor belt, they're purged with carbon dioxide. That carbon dioxide's heavier than room air, and again, part of room air, ambient air, is oxygen, and we talked about that being the enemy at this point. Because it kills your shelf life, it kills the characteristics we all look for in fresh beer, and so it's purged with CO2 to improve our shelf life. It's then filled with the cold carbonated beer from the bottom of the can to the top. It runs through a seamer after a lid is dropped on. The seamer just crimps the lid and the can together so that it's airtight. It then gets rinsed off with water. And then we unload them by hand and put them into 6 or 12 packs, cases, depending on the orders that we have from our distributors. So we use Premier as our distributor in the Omaha market. In Lincoln, we use State Distributing. We're also in the Kansas City market, up in South Dakota. And so those are the states where you can find Brickway at this point anyway. We hope to grow.
Why did you go with cans?
I think craft beer consumers are becoming more and more comfortable with buying beer in a can. From a strictly quality standpoint, it's, you know, without a doubt the superior package. It allows no light, there's no air transfer, like there is to a very small degree with bottles. As far as economics go and impact on the environment, it's much easier to ship. They're much lighter. We can fit more of them in semi trailer, and they degrade a lot quicker than glass does. And so, also I would say working in a brewery of this size, just the ease with which we can move them around, stack them. Move them out of our way when we're not using that particular can stack. The amount of cans we drop in a given day, if it were glass, I can't imagine. It'd be a mess. So I think it's a little of each of those. Mostly, I would say it's just the quality of the package. Yep. Yeah. It's something I think you'll see more and more as time goes on. Statistics show that beer consumers are still getting used to it, but the old saying, beer for a glass in a can, it doesn't impact the quality of the beer going in. There's just an evolution there that takes time to get everybody comfortable with it.
Do you
Is there any kind of inspection or taste testing that goes on during the canning process to make sure the quality is up to par?
Yeah, everything going into the can is tasted along the way, from the brew house through the cellar, at filtration, and then before the canning day begins. So as far as the product inside of the cans, that's the procedure for testing that, making sure it's consistent and where we want quality-wise. As far as the cans themselves, you know, obviously it's kind of an intimidating process, because once that can or keg leaves the premise, it's out of our control, and we certainly don't want people to get a can of beer that's not properly seamed and not carbonated and not drinkable at that point. And so we use micrometers to measure the height and the width of the seams. The seamer can be adjusted in a number of different ways if that seems off, but it's that seam on the can is something we constantly battle to make sure that we're sending beer cans out that'll stand the test of time.
Since it's tasted all throughout the process, at what point does it get like recognizable or doesn't taste like
sugar water? Yeah, right.
Beer that you get.
I would say toward the end of fermentation. If you taste a beer right out of the brew house, that bitterness really, really hits you from those hops. Early in fermentation, it's just incredibly yeasty because of all of the movement. Fermentation is a very active process, and so in the peak of fermentation, there's really no separation of yeast matter, true matter, and the beer. It's just an amalgamous solution. That's mixed up, and so if you were to get a sample and taste it, then the bitterness isn't quite so harsh, but it's certainly not a true representation of where that beer is going to end up. As fermentation's settling down, you can really get a feel for aroma, flavor, color. Early in fermentation, because of that yeast haze, it's even difficult really to judge color at that point. But toward the end of fermentation, and then in the fermenter when the beer is being cooled down. You can start to get a feel for what it's going to be like. Yep. Any other questions at all?
How many cans a day do you
guys produce? Our canning runs are right now limited by the amount of bright tank space that we have. So we've got 60 barrels worth of bright tank space. That would probably be about a 12-hour canning day. Just run time by the time you set up and you clean up. So we do about 30 barrels in a canning run. That's somewhere in the ballpark of 350 cases. So 24 cans in a case. Somebody have to help me with the math. I'm not that good. It's a lot.
8,400 cans.
How many?
8,400.
8,400. Thank you.
Yeah. And you have enough canning every day, or
we can. I would say right now at about the same frequency that we brew 3 to 4 days a week. I can't remember a week where we can every day. And the bottleneck for us right now is space. We would need another bright tank, another tank to hold that beer, carbonate it, which is a 24-hour process, in order to be able to step up that production. We're currently shopping around spaces for barrel storage and things that would open some of this space up to be able to allow us to increase our bright tank space and increase our fermentation space. A brew house in a brewery really is very rarely the bottleneck. We can produce a lot more beer than what we're able to in this space with a 20 barrel brew house. It's the fermentation space, the bright tank space, and then packaging that pose limiting factors on the ultimate output.
So you can theoretically have triple the bright tank space.
Could. Yeah, and that brew house could handle it. We may have to brew, go to a 24-hour brew day, which is kind of the growth step a lot of breweries go through, as opposed to getting a larger brew house and making the investment that requires. Instead, the money is normally spent on vessels, fermentation space, increasing the volume capacity they have in their cellar and their packaging area, as opposed to the hot side.